Everybody, and welcome to Nancy Drew, The Secret of the Scarlet Hand. It is me, Ralphie993, and here's what I thought. There was no previous episode, so I can't say that, but this is my thought. So Hair Interactive recently did a whole, hey, vote for your favorite Nancy Drew game, people, and so they did that, and they had a winner, and I was gonna play that game, so I'm like, oh, okay, that's relevant. However, I don't have that game in my possession, so I thought, well, I can do the next best thing, and we can play my favorite Nancy Drew game, Secret of the Scarlet Hand. So let's get started.
Welcome to my latest.
Yes,
case,
Nancy.
Secret of the Scarlet
Hand. Senior Detective.
Dear Dad,
we're doing this.
Greetings from the new Deputy Curator at Beecher Museum in Washington, D.C. I miss you, by the way. How's Africa? I sure hope this letter reaches you in Ouagadougou before you move on to Nairobi. So I got the internship. Your old friend Franklin Rose was awfully nice to submit my name to the rest of the members of the museum's board of directors. What an opportunity while I'm in between cases. As you probably know, the museum specializes in ancient Maya culture. My supervisor is going to be Joanna Riggs, a well-known archaeologist. Maybe you've seen her name in the news recently, in conjunction with the discovery of a strange Maya monolith. Apparently, it's created quite a buzz among experts in the field. Well, Beech Hill plans to feature the monolith in an upcoming exhibition. Just imagine, this artifact has been buried for hundreds of years, and now it's going to be unveiled to the public for the first time. The museum is short-staffed at the moment, and they're expecting such a huge turnout that they've closed their doors to prepare. I can hardly wait to dig into this exciting project and learn how archaeologists and historians solve the mysteries of ancient cultures. I'll keep you posted. Love, Nancy.
Nancy Drew, I presume. I'm Joanna Riggs. Welcome to Beech Hill. I was just checking the lock on this display case. This is one of the museum's most treasured pieces, a carving of King Pakal.
Who is King Pakal?
Hey, it's Nancy.
Pakal assumed the throne at age 12. Can you imagine? That was 615 AD. He ruled for 68 years at the height of the Maya civilization.
Is that jade?
Yes, the Maya loved jade and used it for many of their carvings. There isn't another piece like this in the world, and it's priceless, which means I practically had to sell my own grandmother to get it.
Oh.
How did the museum acquire it?
Leave it to Taylor Sinclair. He's a wizard when it comes to these deals. You'll meet him later.
The text and the audio never match
now
up there.
Nancy, you're coming on board at a critical time for Beech Hill. An exhibit of this caliber is not kid stuff. Franklin Rose assures me you're a real trooper, and I hope he's right, because I'm not here to babysit. I don't care who your father is.
Oh, that's rude, but don't worry. Nancy's got this. She's done things. Well, she's only done a few things since this game, but she's done other things, and she's got this. I got this.
I'm glad
we
to
got
be
this.
Here. Please, tell me more about the exhibit.
In addition to our permanent collection, we're borrowing rare pieces from museums and private collectors around the world. Soon we'll be sitting on the most fabulous collection of Maya artifacts ever assembled in one place. And now that we've scored the monolith, too, Beech Hill Sora numero uno.
So this monolith, it seems very important, or at least very important to have.
This monolith, it's an important discovery?
Yes, a hot young team of archaeologists,
Americans
and Mexicans both, dug it out of a cave near Palenque. Every curator from here to Siberia was trying to get a hold of it, but I'm the one who closed the deal.
Oh, what does it look like?
What does this monolith look like?
It's a massive pillar of stone, nearly 1,500 years old, with Maya glyphs carved into it. We've installed it in the garden. Wait until you see it.
Oh, so we do get to see it. That's awesome. We have the privilege of seeing this stuff. Well, granted, we're an internship. We get to work behind the scenes in the museum. We have the privilege to look at everything we want.
Could you explain what a glyph is?
A glyph, as in hieroglyphic,
Nancy.
Is a picture that represents a word or an idea. Henrik is the human encyclopedia on the subject.
Who's Henrik? I don't have the option to ask who Henrik is. I don't like knowing people without actually knowing more about them.
How many glyphs are there in all?
Henrik can help you with
Thank
that.
Thank you. Who's Henrik?
Who's Henrik?
Henrik
He's a guy.
Vanderhoon, world-renowned expert in Maya hieroglyphics. He's the latest addition to the Beech Hill Brain Trust. I told him I don't even want to see his pointy Vander head till he's got a translation on that monolith.
Okay, so he's working on the glyphs. Sounds good. They mean something very important.
Do you think the glyphs hold an important message?
I really don't know. The Maya were at their peak during Pakal's reign. After he died, things began to go downhill. The civilization never regained the oomph it had under its most extraordinary king.
Perhaps, you know, reading into these glyphs, figuring out what the writing of these ancient cultures is, might tell you why things went downhill. Could you imagine if some of these, like, ancient cultures still existed today? Granted, they probably wouldn't be so ancient. They would probably be more, like, modernized, like a lot of people are. Unless, like, they're isolated and they don't have a whole bunch of contact. But even then, they still have, like, if you want to call it modern clothing and whatnot.
If the message on that monolith is from King Pakal himself, it might give us a clue. Credit for a discovery like that can only spell one thing, my dear. R-E-V-E-N-U-E. Anyway, there's a list of tasks for you in the lab. Once you've knocked those off, we'll regroup.
Oh, okay.
Shouldn't I have more training?
Don't worry, you'll be in the swing of things soon enough. Go ahead and take a look around the museum. I'm sure you'll find the monolith, muy interesante. Or just roll up your sleeves and hit the lab.
Interesting. Probably best to check out the museum first before we do any actual tasks. And she's letting us do that anyways.
Thanks for the orientation, Joanna. I'll talk to you later.
Bye.
Bye. I know, actually, one of my things, like, whenever I start a new job, it's like, do I have enough training? I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just standing around looking like an idiot. And it's always, like, that initial, like, set of panic that I get because I don't know what I'm doing. I've been thrust into this new situation. The Great Plaza of, I don't know what that says, Taital? Guatemala? I don't know. It looks like a pretty cool Mayan, or, well, probably Mayan. Maybe Aztecs. Nah, Aztec, well, it could be. I don't really know how the Mayans and the Aztecs have their overlapping of cultures and times and space and stuff. I think the Mayans were a little bit further north, but don't quote me on that. Anyways, let's snoop through Joanna's office. We got a ton, like, it seems like the museum here has dedicated itself to, like, Mayan artifacts and stuff like that, because a lot of it is all Mayan stuff. Like, usually a museum, like the Royal BC Museum, you know, has, like, well, but last time I went there, it had, like, a rotating Titanic exhibit, and then it had, like, you know, people of North America, animals of Canada, that sort of stuff. They have a variety of exhibits. But let's sim through our magazines. Art in the Americas, Hidden Guatemala. An Interview with Prudence Rutherford by Daphne Wu. Shall I read it? Yeah, why not? Let's read it. How did a New York society woman like yourself end up in Topeka, Kansas? My husband Herbert Laszlo was a hydro engineer, and when he appointed the head of the Kansas River Flood Control Project, naturally, we came to Topeka. When Herbert drowned, everyone thought I would make a beeline back to New York, but after 36 years in Topeka, I just didn't have the heart to leave. The truth is, this is my home now. Just as an aside, I find it interesting that you never took his name. That was almost unheard of at the time of your marriage, wasn't it? That seems a little bit personal, but I guess it is an interview with her. Yes, well, I never was one to worry about conventions, and where I come from, once a Rutherford, always a Rutherford. Well, you certainly have been trailblazer. Now, back in Topeka, what about your love for the arts? What in the world do you do for culture and entertainment here? Oh my stars, don't underestimate Topeka, dear. The arts are alive and well here. We have theater, symphony, and over 20 art galleries. I organize the St. Patrick's Day Parade, the Corn Growers Ball, and I sit on the board of the Topeka Commission for the Arts, too. This is the capital of Kansas, after all. I didn't know that.
Topeka Commission for the Arts. How cultured.
How cultured. It is cultured. Very much so indeed, Nancy. Ms. Rutherford, Art Appraiser is thrilled to be featuring your Fire Ruby necklace in this month's issue. Please tell us about this extraordinary piece of jewelry. The necklace originally belonged to Herbert's mother, Hester, rest her soul. We never got along. Oh, but those rubies really did blaze like a burning ring of fire around her neck. You had a necklace altered when you inherited it, is that right? Yes, well, Hester's spirit was just a bit too overpowering for the necklace. I felt like I was going to be strangled whenever I wore it, so I decided to add a piece for my own family to balance out the energies and, you know, make it my own. The spirit necklace, I guess she added that part right there, this part. You must be referring to that extraordinary jade piece. Tell us about it. My great-grandfather, Ruffleton Rutherford, I feel like these names are a little silly, was once the premier archaeologist of his day. This jade carving came from one of his most groundbreaking digs. Whoops, no pun intended. At a Mayan ruin in the Amazon jungle. I believe the year was 1898. So this is a real Maya artifact? Yes, carved by real Maya hands. And isn't it just amazing to think how many more hands this piece has passed through on its way to the 21st century Topeka? Oh my stars, it gives me goosebumps. Any idea what the carving symbolizes? So that's the carving there. Well, this picture is a glyph. In my culture, it stands for a number of things. Snake, green, south, and I'm not sure what else. Fascinating. Isn't it, though? The necklace has one of my most prized possessions. That's why I keep it at the villa. I just can't bear to have it locked up in some cold bank vault where I can never see it or wear it. The insurance company advises me against it, but I tell them, jewelry is to be worn and enjoyed, darlings. Don't you agree? Certainly, Miss Rutherford. And now with this article, many more people will be able to enjoy your extraordinary necklace. Thank you for taking the time to talk to us. The pleasure was all mine. Well, that also allows people to know that you have this actual Mayan artifact, which actually, surprisingly enough, the rules and regulations have changed, but you can't actually take actual artifacts from archaeological sites anymore. Otherwise, you become a treasure hunter, and everybody frowns against that. But you can get replicas made, and those are kind of cool too, because you know at least, oh, hey, it's not the real thing, but you won't be looked at as a criminal, but you'll have a thing that looks like the real thing. That's not as bad. Anyways, let's check out this museum. So it's kind of like the foyer, I guess, or I think it has an official name, but I don't really know. Lost Civilization Speaks. From when? They're holding it from September 29th to April 30th. I think it's really cool that some museums do have the rotating exhibit so that, like, everybody gets to experience it. Oh, look! A paper airplane. Alright, more information. Addenda to the Palenque Monolith Loan Contract between the Republic of Mexico and Beecham Museum, Washington, D.C., USA. Paragraph 7, Section 8A. Beecham shall make two payments of $250,000. Wow, that's a lot. The first being paid upon execution of this contract, the second being paid not upon delivery but 30 days after the delivery of the property. Section 10A, during the loan, shall be 90 days from the opening of the exhibit, and no more than, looks like someone's extended the days as well. Section 1C of paragraph 12, during the period of the loan, Beech Hill shall have the exclusive rights to reproduce images of the property for the following derivative works. So, yeah, so you need to get authority to, oh, and mouse pads. You can't forget the mouse pads. Let's see here, paragraph 20, section 22D. Beech Hill shall assume full liability in the amount of, oh, only $1 million, not $5 million, for the property of the duration of the agreement. So it definitely sounds like this has been altered to suit one person's needs, Beech Hill's. And it looks like, I'm guessing, Joanna Riggs altered this herself. So Joanna signed it, and it looks like we need Alejandro Del Rio to sign it as well. So, oh, we get to keep that, so perhaps that is a task for our list. Alright, what else do we have? We've got plaques. That's Joanna's office. So the plaques here. Major contributors to Beech Hill Museum. So just a bunch of people, I suppose. Got regular people. Bubba Fatsis. That's a very interesting name. I want to know where they get these names from. I feel like some of them are just, like, pulled out of their asses, and it's just, like, Salamander Jones. Like, they have to have some sort of meaning behind it. Maybe they're, like, nicknames or something like that.
Commission for the Arts. That's the organization Prudence Rutherford works for.
So Prudence Rutherford's commission, I guess. I don't want to repeat what Nancy said. Seems to donate a lot. Oh, and here we have ND Fan 123. Well, you gotta have some sort of little Easter egg like that now, don't we? Alright, let's check out front desk. What do we got here? The Traveler's Guide to Beech Hill Museum. This is Akaho? Akaho. God of Travelers. It seems to be his glyph. Alright, so we must be in the rotunda then. So then we have the exhibition hall, the temple, and the garden in the back. Oh, here we have Kukulkan, the wind god. And Zaman North. I don't have any idea how to actually pronounce these words, so those will probably all be butchered if anybody happens to know the Mayan language and pronunciations. We got some cool headphones. Those are probably to aid with the exhibit. But we can't have any now because we don't have the knob. Funny thing to be missing. Is the knob in the drawer? No, but we do have a ton of cards. Binding the Maya Temple Key Card. Bih, Mayan glyph for road. That's cool. I like it how this game has, like, okay, wait, no, different train of thought, but kind of the same train of thought. This game is one of my favorite games for kind of two main reasons. Number one, this game is classified as edutainment. It is an educational entertainment game because you get to learn all this cool stuff about the Mayan exhibit, like the Mayan culture, the Mayan lifestyle, the Mayan civilization. And this whole exhibition hall here can tell us lots of neat things about, like, arts and crafts, gods, languages, who they were, their kings, their rituals, all that sort of neat stuff. And then we even have more in the garden in the back, which we probably won't get to this episode. I don't know when I'm going to end this off. And we have all these cool things we get to look at. And we get to learn about these things, assuming that I have never actually cross-referenced to make sure any of this stuff is actually right, but I assume it is, because why would you put false information in an edutainment game? Secondly, this game has one of the formats that I like the most, where you run around and you collect a whole bunch of information, or you find puzzles, but you don't have the puzzles or the information yet to put all those things together. And it's not linearized, it's kind of like there's like stuff from your entire journey. Sorry, it doesn't look like I'm doing anything. I'm talking with my hands at the moment. But you find all this stuff to complete your mystery, to complete your journey, to complete your final task. And that's what's super cool about this game. So, I think before the episode ends, let's get some of this boring stuff over. There's a lot of reading we have to do. Or should we do the reading in the next episode? We gotta go through the exhibit. We gotta familiarize ourselves with what we're learning. Anytime you get a new job, folks, here's a tip if you want to get a job. Know what your company does. So, we're being an intern. We should know what the company, museum, is talking about in order to be able to better understand ourselves with what our job entails. So, how many minutes do I have? I don't know. How about not enough? Let's say in the next episode, we educate ourselves. We will learn about the Mayan civilization. I don't like that white glow there. It looks like it could be like a creepy person standing there. But anyways. So, I thank you guys for watching this first episode of Nancy Drew's Secret of the Scarlet Hand, and I will see you guys in the next one.